The obvious is not always the reality.
Okay. Right. Now, the reason I gave this talk was so that we can learn to use the symbols, because astrology is very emotional, and perhaps I was tuning in and understanding what it is to look at those symbols really helps us to understand those energies that are working sometimes on an unconscious level in our charts. Right? As far back as history, of course, men and women have sought an explanation for things not easily explained by everyday existence and the struggle for survival. We've always been aware of and held in awe some very mysterious creative forces which in human terms are almost incomprehensible. But they're not of the order and harmony of the universe, the dance of the sun and the moon and the stars, the planets, and the seasons which appear to control life on Earth. There had to be something out there, something more intelligent and more powerful than the human mind can grasp. They say God created man in his own image. Or, alternatively, did man create God in his own image? In either case, there's a saying which is particularly valid, which is as above, so below, which is very much beloved by astrologers because it indicates the universality of things and the unity of the universe of which we are part. But when humans learn to work with the universal law, their lives can become more harmonious and take on more meaning. It's easier to understand this principle these days in the days of the computer and the microchip and the cloning of cells, where one minute particle can actually, if it is isolated, take on the properties of the larger whole, being an exact replica. So the microcosm, the microorganism, can actually holds within it the seeds of the macroorganism, the microcosm. So out of the universal unconscious came archetypes, larger than life archetypes, larger than life figures, which seemed to span seemingly unrelated cultures, like the Greeks and the Romans, the Egyptians, the Incas, the Norsemen, all have a mythology which, if it's examined, is very similar. We find the same themes, the same figures recurring in all of the cultures. And these trigger off, even in modern civilizations, a deep response and the recognition of energies that are deep within ourselves, which have been projected and externalized onto gods, goddess figures, who in all cases are remarkably human, with all their virtues, human virtues, and foibles, and their jealousy and passion. They rule our lives seemingly externally, but if we prepare to quote, we find that they link very strongly with our own motivations and compulsions. The archetypes are extremely deeply ingrained within us, and but if we look, we can find continual reminders of these archetypes. If I give talks to groups who know very little about astrology, I often bring this up, how every day of our lives we are using simple astrological terms, which perhaps surprises people when you really look at it. I mean, how many times do people say many happy returns, and they really don't realise that they're wishing someone many happy solar returns. Solar returns, the day of the year on which the sun comes back to the same point in the zodiac from which it started. All right? So every time someone says any happy returns, they're using symbolic astrological language.
Yes. Because nothing that sort of happens, right?
That's right. Well, many people do become quite surprised when they realise that. And of course, every planet has a return. The fact that we talk about solar returns means that the sun has come back to its natal point. I'm not going to get into the planetary cycles at the moment, but I like to wish people many Jupiter returns. Jupiter comes back to its natal position roughly every 12 years. So not only is it a joyful time and the beginning of a new joyful growth cycle, but it's wishing them success and joy for the next 12 years, not just for the next 1 year. So see, that's a different story altogether, getting into the planetary cycles, which I'm not really dealing with at the moment. I'm just pointing out how often we use these symbols without recognizing it. How about the days of the week too? I think in most cultures there's been a specific day set aside for a particular god or a particular goddess, and things of the nature of that god or goddess are adhered to on that particular day. We start the week with Sunday, naturally that's fairly explainable, the sun, the centre of the universe, the creative force from which all life springs, could in theory be the day when we pay reverence to the sun. We next come to the next most important planet, moon, moon day. Right? On Monday, things of the moon, when we theoretically get in touch with our emotions. I've sort of put this across to groups too, how it's really quite interesting to try and tune in to these archetypes by tuning into the days of the week, by contemplating the sun on a Sunday and what it means to us, and what it means in our lives, what it means in our natal chart, the moon, being strongly attached to our emotions. You know, it's not by accident that the term Monday Blues comes out and no one really wants to get structured and down to earth and start working. Tuesday, that's a little bit more obscure. You've sometimes got to go to other languages to really make the link. That's Mardi in French, Mars's day. Right? I think the day of the week should begin with Tuesday, with Mars's day, because input of energy bursts the strength, the initial input of energy, when we can really go out and achieve and do things, be physically active and do all these things that we've been wanting to do.
Also, Tuesday was named after the Norse god too, who's like
right.
Mars' counterpoint.
That's right.
And
yes,
he was
yes.
a very aggressive god
yes.
in Norse mythology.
That's right. I'm fascinated with that link with Norse mythology and with the Greek and Roman. I don't know how the link came about, whether there had been some contact or whether it purely sprang from some great universal unconscious. It was absolutely fascinating.
Would these be better days, like Monday? Would that be a better day for a person to rule by the moon?
Rule by the moon? I should think it would be, because
yes,
that's their natural
be
way of functioning.
More exuberant on a...
But, yeah. It's very, but it's also very difficult for that person to get structured to start their working week
yeah.
on that particular day, when they probably want to just flow with whatever's going on, whatever the structure means.
I think I've got Monday is Monday.
Monday is Tuesday. Tuesday, Mars' day. And Wednesday, no, that's Norse.
Mercury.
Woden. Mercury. Mercury's day.
Mm.
Woden. I think there is a correspondence between Woden and Mercury, although it's not given as such in the correspondence. But there is a link. There is a link between the two.
Mercury is sort of like he's the god that goes between the worlds and like...
The
word
between the worlds, the messenger of God.
The word is from, it's called the thing as well.
Yes, that's right, between the two worlds.
Yes,
there is a link.
The psychopomp, I think it's called, isn't it?
The
psychopomp.
Yes, that's right.
It's the psychopomp is the being that acts as the guide for the dead.
That's right.
You know,
that's right.
Sometimes
so
it was ravens, sometimes
yes.
it was...
There's another Norse god too, but... Oh no, that's I've got more down here. Right, so... we've got Wednesday, tuning in with those two cultures. That kind of totally fascinating. Thursday, of course, is Thor's day.
Mm-hmm.
It's understandable. Thor, the thunder god. And, of course, again in French, we have Jeudi, which I think it might be a derivation of Jupiter, but it certainly is the day associated with Jupiter.
In German and Dutch, it's thunder.
Oh, Donnerstag. Yeah, Thank you. That's right. You see, you know, my main thing before I got into astrology was language. Language again. I suppose it's gentleman, gentleman, right? Language being the link, right? Mercury being the bridge, where we can find all these little keys and clues when we start to link up. Friday is Freya's day. Freya is
Venus.
Right? I'm getting the picture.
Yeah.
When we just set a day of the week, we say it's so unthinkingly. And really, if we can just tune in to the energies of that day, we're really very much getting in touch with the archetypes and the mythological figures from which all this sprang.
Also, Friday, the TGIF concept of thank God it's Friday, it's always very social.
Social,
which is very Venus.
Social, not much work gets done on a Friday, don't
yeah, and party.
And preparing for the weekend and the release from the duties of work, and we can look to our pleasures. And I always laugh about Saturn coming after a present day, the day of repentance.
Yeah, that's you spent all your money in shops and doing all your
religious
things.
Repent, repent on Saturday for the excesses of Thursday and Friday. Okay? You see where I'm coming from here. So, yes, of course, Saturday. It's very hard sometimes to equate Saturn with the day that we tend to associate with our day of leisure, our weekend day. But I'm sure...
Saturn, in Roman times, they had this festival called Saturnalia, which was it was equated with the Christmas in our time. But Saturnalia was very joyous, giving up gifts and relaxing.
Oh, of course, because the old concept of Saturn too was quite different from what we see now. We have some surprises when we look into Saturn in mythology.
Well, there was a lot of illusions that were based around Saturn, and the idea of even as Kronos, being the crow god, but that's actually in the time description.
Yes,
of course, there was a Greek word that was very similar, start with the H.
Right.
On Saturday, like if you've been working from Monday to Friday, and you had your bust on Friday night, and you're going to have to start work on Monday and ramp up Sunday, and Saturday is most probably the thing where you're going to have to restructure your whole being again, and then have your Sunday, and then possibly you're going to be ready for Monday. And it's housekeeping. And I don't find in society that don't have a Monday-Friday life.
True, but it's also the last day of the week, and Saturn was the Artemis planet.
Yeah,
I see Saturn too as a tidying up and a tying up of loose ends. And a tying up of loose ends, and perhaps looking towards our other responsibilities, perhaps our family, perhaps to look to where Saturn is on our chart to see where we should be putting responsibility into our Saturdays. Okay, does that make sense?
So each day of the week you look to where the ruling planet is in your chart.
That's right. Yes, this is what I'm trying to tie in.
I came in late.
It's okay. We're getting it moving. Sort of moving the energy in our chart and helping us to tune in more to the understanding. And for those of you who are beginners, some of you are, some of you aren't, it really helps to try to tune in as deeply as you can to your own chart, see what it means for you. But it doesn't end there, of course, because quite often when you say the sun or the moon to someone else, it can mean something quite different. I'm going to try with an experiment in a moment, too. We can do it with a small one.
I've got Saturn in Virgo, and I know that in my life, when I was working weekly, Saturday was when I got my house in order in a Virgo manner.
Also, yes, even these days, where you have households where everyone is working, Saturday is the day. experience at Baddies, because we are getting what we deserve from the effort that we've already put in. So if we've really tied up those ends on the Saturday.
So looking at Saturn itself, it's such a beautiful golden, flame orange.
Oh, it
and then just the other night it was so clear.
Yes.
And instead of, I couldn't see it as this grumpy old threatening
house,
it looked like a present to me. Here was this warble hanging in the sky.
It is glorious.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to talk a little more about Saturn. I know the night we went to the observatory to look at Halley's comet, I think everyone came away raving not about the comet, but about seeing Saturn in its rings. Brilliant. Right.
Did you see those slides last night? The Fred had?
No.
Well, Saturn looks so absolutely meticulous, the photographs of the...
Oh, yes.
It wasn't it?
And of course the rings, with the Saturn having been the outer limits of our experience too, the rings are very symbolic. That there they are, it's bound by these rings, and the space posts have discovered that the makeup of the rings is frozen ice, salt and dust, and then we have that crystallization of Saturn. It has totally amazed me too. There's nothing why I'd be, reason why I would be looking at this is that the ancient definitions of the planets have been proven by science. How did they know that Saturn was associated with crystals and Uranus was all lopsided and the most erratic body? How did they know? Oh, well,
because I could see. Actually, I read a fascinating book not long ago. It was I read snippets of it. There was a man who came to New Zealand back in very, very early times as a European settlement, and he talked to the Maoris a lot and everything like that. And he said that their vision was astonishing. They could look at Jupiter and see the moons. They could look at Saturn and see the rings.
This was the Maori.
Yeah, just with a more eyesight.
Yes, yeah, that's true. I read a book that was sitting in a doctor's waiting room, and I didn't finish it because I had to go. But it was about Maori astronomy, and it was talking about Jupiter with its family, its moons.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it kind of stunned me. I thought, how did this, in inverted commas, primitive, some people may think, from centuries ago, know about Jupiter's moons, know how to work with the planetary energies, because, again, I didn't mention the Maori mythology either when I was talking about the different cultures, but they had it too, and they had the same archetypes, if you really look. And although our knowledge is fairly scanty, we don't know enough about the Maori mythology. But it's partly how people
do. Do you know whether the Maoris divided time into weeks, days and weeks? Or if that was more of a Western invention?
I don't know.
I don't think they did actually.
It's like the American Indians didn't work on days of the week, they worked on moon cycles. So it was, you know, I'll meet you on the quarter moon, or I'll meet you on the full moon.
That's why it's an emotional, spiritual, sensitive type of culture, a lunar culture rather than a solar culture. And lunar cultures have been having a hard time late. Right? But going on that, I know that I'm getting off on a tangent, but this is good. I think it was when the Parkers were out here last year, and they were mentioning that sun sign astrology is a very modern invention. The first sun sign columns in the papers appeared in about the 1930s, I think it was. But they were talking about when people, going back to Shakespeare and to Chaucer, And when they say that they were born under a certain sign, they were not talking about the sun sign, they were talking about the ascendant. Now, so originally, the ascendant was what was all important. Right? That was the personalized part. Okay? And I found that really interesting. I didn't know that. And so the sun sign is the development of knowing of sun sign is fairly recent. And it has sort of almost coincided with the worship we put on the solar energy, the solar culture, and omitting the more the lunar side. Okay, there's another reinforcement of solar positive scientific, and sort of not being as much in touch with the personalized. Maybe the sun in that chart is a personalized point too. But when it gets to the point where you're grouping whole chart of the population into one thing, bang, 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 it's it's not really what astrology is all about.
Just going on that, have you ever seen any charts that are from astrologers, say, in the medieval days or something like that, to see what? Have you ever had any insight into that through your reading and study? Whether they could use the sun or not?
Oh, they use it, obviously.
No, they give it more emphasis than the
I've seen very little different interpretation. Anyone else throw any light on that?
Robert Handwrack's quite a bit about it. Well, he has looked at some of the charts of the ancient Greeks, how they set them up, the Egyptians, and the medieval group, and evidently they had very rigid interpretations. Where now we tend to be more psychologically oriented in terms of the development of the individual. In ancient times, it was real formulated astrology. That if you had Jupiter on the midheaven, you would have a blessed life, and you would be royalty.
Yeah,
it was very emphatic kind of formula stuff. Mm-hmm. But he's got a good book out called his essays, Robert Hand's Essays on Astrology.
Mm-hmm.
Have a look at that. I think he writes a bit about it in there.
Yes.
But he gave a talk at the FAA conference in Melbourne 2 years ago. He did a day's workshop on sort of that subject, which is quite fascinating.
Okay, I'll just go back under this a little bit for a little while. Just noting the fact that the gods demanded the recognition and the admiration of humans. And if they were ignored or failed to be recognized, then their retribution could be pretty drastic, right? So also, of course, at our peril, we ignore the archetypal energies that are within us, that are striving for expression, that they are suppressed, ignored, or contravened, then the consequences can often be fairly difficult, shall we say.
Yes, they did.
Mm-hmm.
If you see the photographs in the early days, about 1936 or thereabouts, there were two buildings. That way, and the other wings, they built out because they reckon with the increasing population that there would be quite a few that were.
Was the most important time of my life. I would not have had it any other way, because I have come through and seen its purpose, and I'm now working on a different level. And when we look at Pluto in mythology too, the god of the underworld, he takes his beings down at the end of the life. And there are very few that he allows to rise again, to return. Okay? But it is not impossible. People have been returned. He has been persuaded to release some of his subjects.
And when you do come back, it's far more refreshing than Coca-Cola.
Right. It's interesting too that I think all mythologies start with chaos of some form, and this is the perhaps primitive human's attempt to put order into chaos. They have to find some explanation for the creation and how things have come to run in an ordered way. And most mythologies do start with chaos and the emergence from the chaos of a god, from whom, who is the god force, and from whom spring the other gods, goddesses. And they're all parts of the same, yet they're the logical development, and each emotion or aspect of our lives is personified and externalized into deity form. Sometimes it's all just too much, too difficult for us all to deal with within ourselves. So it is symbolized for us in the form of gods, deities.
Can I ask you a question? Is that an ongoing process in human life, or do we just recreate current images of the old archetypes? Are we creating new archetypes, do you think?
Yes, I think new archetypes are being created, but only the ones that spring from the old ones.
Perhaps
you weaken.
I think humans are things of God makers. I mean, we're doing it all the time.
Yes.
And particularly if you see people right now, and they're changing the face of, say, the Christian God, and what he's doing,
that's
and how
right.
he's expanding.
That's right. There are so many different images of the Christian God, of the which, you know, if you just take it all back, it is all the same force.
It's a recognition of that force.
Yes. As an astrologer, I'm often asked, you know, do you believe in God? Do you believe in Jesus? Obviously. Do you believe in Jesus? Or, you know, friends who are very religious, and you know, what do you say? You say yes.
You just say yes, I've got his address.
You've got his chart.
And I confound people, you know.
I often ask them, believe what?
Yeah,
that's
a good
problem. Yeah.
He's
on that
mailing list. Right. Now, seeing across just a small group, and I'd like to, while we're talking about messages about the planets, perhaps I'll just reorganise how I seem to do it, and we'll just have a little think about what we mean by tuning into the sun and the moon. And I'd like you all to just silently close your eyes, if you like, think of the sun, the image of the planet, the planet itself, the symbol of what it means to you in your chart, or the sun.
My German
teacher told me that the moon was a male because no self-respecting woman would be out alone so late at night.
But it's not in French. It's the other way around in French.
Do you know what happened?
reflected on water. I didn't actually see the sun, I saw its reflection. And it was very bright, and I looked where I was, and I was on a beach, and there was a palm tree on the left-hand side. And the sun was probably just about to set. It was sort of low in the sky.
Where is 10th house?
10th house. So it could have been just rising. Yeah, but it was just sort of, you know, from standing, it was probably about 60 degrees up the horizon.
Yes.
So it was a low sun. It wasn't.
Can you share your sun sign with us?
Pisces.
Yeah. you see what I'm doing?
Yes, that's great.
I hadn't intended to do this. It's a lovely time to do it.
Oh, I'd like you to do this too.
And if your Gemini rising is attracting a lot of Gemini energy.
Yes,
and
I've got some Gemini here.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, you know what we're doing there, you know? Can we just, I'm just going to do it with time, and we're not going to go through the lot, but could you just switch off for a moment and tune into your moon? The moon. The death of the cycle, the ending of the cycle.
Oh, yes.
which bears within it the seeds of the new cycle which emerges out of the ascendant.
The other thing too is this is from me. Seeing I haven't been in astrology, it's completely raw. This is just how I feel.
That's good. That's
so
well. That's
yes,
better.
We just dropped onto
it's
this.
Often better to do it like that when you're not influenced by all the intellectualizing of it.
That's right.
What time is it in?
It's in 12.
And then the sign?
Aquarius.
Aquarius. So, we're probably choosing to go as sort of unusual, bearing it.
Yes,
you triggered a little bell.
Well, that's right. Something like that just sort of triggers it up and you think, gee, that's quite bright. You know?
But also, the statement that my German teacher made, it's a very personalized way of looking at the moon. I think of Aquarius as a human sign.
Mm.
Like Aquarius is a human being carrying water. And so often the Aquarian influence is an attempt to humanize things that are not easily accessible.
Mm.
So, naming your favorite, naming your car, I think is a really Aquarian thing to do. Or, putting a personality to an inanimate object.
Yes.
It's very clear.
Yes.
Yes.
Good one. And it's you're hiding it. What did you get an image?
I think of the moon always as a full moon. It didn't occur to me that the moon also comes like that, really. But it's I'm always surprised that the moon will actually cause the tides here, because I see it as an impotent and not a powerful thing. Because it is a dead planet, and there's also no dark side of the moon.
There's some dark side of the moon, isn't it?
Okay, can you share with us where your moon is?
It's in the fifth house, but I'm not sure what that is. Oh, Pisces in the sevens.
It's an Aquarius. Yeah. Alright. So we've got some fairly unusual revelations. This sort of is just shot your theory down. I am afraid. the Aquarian moon can tend to depersonalize. Can't see it as a relating human thing.
Well, he did say he always sees it as
full
blown and not in the smaller modes of it.
Right. But also, I had an interesting thought with your son being on the seventh house cusp. Anyway, it gives you a full moon type of feel because it's opposing your ascendant, the other side of you, which is your personal projection. It's an opposition, ascendant, descendant.
No, it's not in opposition. I'm not putting it wrong.
No. If your son's on the seventh house cusp, alright, which is directly opposite the ascendant. And to me, any opposition between any planets or points, has a full moon type of feel. Effect is open, it's susceptible, it's open to influxes, things like that. So you have got it.
That's why he thought of it.
Perhaps you're living in the full moon type of thing anyway. Okay, William.
Well, actually, when I closed my eyes before to look at the sun, there were central things black, which was the sun, and one of was this pale green. And I thought, why have I got the sun and the moon together? Why is the moon larger than the sun? And then the moon disappeared and the sun was pulsating and I got the message of life and non-life.
Mm-hmm.
Well, anyway, my mother, because the moon is the mother. My mother was Pisces, and I've also heard in astrology things about Pisces being one of the sort of nymphed sort of things, but my mother was like, she had a volcanic aspect to her nature. And of course, I know when the sea is enraged by wind and things, which the children's noise on, my mother was and in sort of a way, perhaps I see my mother as a distant being in a certain one way, although I was quite close to her in one another level. But I was just wondering if that sort of connects to my
sure.
concept.
Of you know, obviously, close conjunction of a planet to the moon will colour your perception of the moon.
Yeah.
You know, that we're just looking at isolating things. If you can take the whole thing, the whole childhood concept, it can explain a lot of things. But
by some moons, it was interesting. I think that my mother dominated the house, but it wasn't really like that. My subsequent experience, I really think
she did it subtly,
in
a plutonic way.
Well, she was sort of bigger than him, and I must have got, you know,
yeah.
into my own private
but,
life.
Okay, but, you know, there again, I've got some very strong archetypal images.
Yeah. I also felt
what
that.
What sign is it?
Cancer.
Cancer, that's right. Because theoretically, the moon should be very strong for you. But
I would say it is.
It
yeah,
is.
Because I was very.
Yeah, but it is. But I was just sort of puzzled by the eclipsing of it.
Well,
yeah, yes, even though it was being eclipsed, it was still there.
There's one phase of the moon. It's often in autumn when the moon is almost red like a sun at the harvest time, you know, and sometimes you see it come over the hill. It's enormous.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's more like the sun than the moon.
Yeah,
and I respond to it more in that form than I do in some that's more ethereal
okay.
and delicate.
So that's
yeah.
there we have the moon, Cancer, the lunar. Principle too for those who are very much working with the moon, influence of the moon, it can appear more large, more real than the sun. I have found that happening before.
Only those times.
When Pluto lets it.
Seems to be.
My own experience of I've got a very a reasonably close anyway a conjunction of Neptune to the moon, and you know when we first. Did this. I had this image of a full moon floating in a sea of silver clouds and its path trailing across the sea. It was still and sort of colourless and totally ethereal, totally spirit. And it is just so beautiful, my image of the moon. And then I got all these sort of weird reactions.
Thought of their
moon.
It
can't be right.
It's not
my moon they're talking about.
That's right. Because see, we all have a personal
appetite. I have one memory of a particular moon. And I was in England at the time, and I was on a train, and I was going down to the west part of England, the southwest part of England, and it was late summer, and it was harvest time. And this moon really was orange, and it was pulsating. Now, that really threw me because I never thought of the moon as capable of pulsating. I know it's reflecting light, and it's really doing its reflection. I'll never forget that as a little I don't remember saying things in my life, but I can remember that event.
The harvest moon is always moved around the clouds and
yeah.
the
mm-hmm.
field.
That's right, it wasn't harvest moon, it was harvest time.
Okay, Glenn, can you share your moon with us?
I've got, first of all, I didn't actually get a moon to set up on. It's got this amazing silver fish and my moon's in Pisces. It's swimming around and it's just big, woody black, deep sea. And it's all water. It's just and I tried to sort of get up out of the sea and see if there wasn't a moon actually out there, and I did this for just get this picture to look at the moon with the face in it.
Whereabouts in the chart?
Yeah.
The 11th. So
The image I got was being naked in a garden with my lover and a full moon above.
Dare you show what your moon is?
It's a Libra moon. I was born on a full moon.
And you're born on a full moon. But I know we're not exactly on the course that I originally intended, but we're still dealing with those archetypes. And it's astounded me when I first did this. What different concepts come into people's minds when you say the sun or when you say the moon? And this is totally modified my way of approaching a chart, because I had to try it for myself into the place of someone who has a sun in Sagittarius in the fifth house, and my moon in Taurus in the 12th house, to try and get into that archetypal image. Alright, are you with me?
Mm-hmm.
Can I just show you too? Which,
you have to share acquaintance.
I must share acquaintance with my husband. It really is rather amusing, because he's not an astrologer. He loves it, he loves the people, but he hasn't patience to learn it. I tried it on him, I just sprung it on him. I said, close your eyes and think about the sun. What do you get? And he said, it's a heaving, seething, red, gaseous mass. Anyone like to guess what sign?
I really know it's called
red, gaseous, seething, popping, and always erupting. Not far off. I have got Mars close. any other suggestions?
Is it
Saturn? No.
Perhaps it'd be Venus.
Scorpio.
They've got it.
That's right.
They've got it. What else? He's got four planets in Scorpio. Interesting. All right.
Because
it's
your Taurus too, aren't you?
Yeah.
Rationalizing
aside of Aquarius. And also, when you talk about the depersonalizing of the Aquarian world, say no intuitively anyway. It doesn't matter.
Yes, I have a Scorpio parent, and when I asked her a question about a feeling, she turned to me, looked at me, and said, "It's none of your business how I feel."
You're in trouble when your client does that to you.
That's sort of lack of commitment there, isn't it? They just won't commit themselves.
They will commit. When they commit themselves, they commit themselves
so hard. This is right, because a lot of games in between will be in that time.
Yeah, it's just reminds me of a story. I don't know, you might have actually heard of it, but there was one of Brian Clark's who, when he was in New Zealand, and he was just saying how he came across a woman who had a triple Scorpio, you know, seeing a woman and sun on Scorpio. And he asked her, "What is it like to be a triple Scorpio?" And she sort of turned to him and said, "Well, it's none of your business."
Okay, so you've got to be able to put yourself into someone else's unconscious archetype of what it is. Okay, well, what I was going to sort of talk about the actual myths of the things, but we've got straight away into talking what it means to us personally. Okay, now maybe we can backtrack and have a look at the actual myths. The sun has always been a mystery, I think, or was, until it was actually discovered that the world was round, and that the astronomy of the universe is totally different from what everyone imagined. The sun was seen as, in most cultures, as a very powerful force. It was worshipped as the major god in many cultures. And I've got to keep trying to stay back on Roman, Greek images, because those are the ones we're really using in our charts. And the sun was actually driven, it was seen as a golden chariot that was driven by the sun god, Hyperion, originally, who was later succeeded Apollo, who also in the Roman mythology was descriptive of the essence of young manhood, all the graces, the beauty. And he also was the god of music and creativity and prophecy. I didn't realise that until I was looking at that, which is nice to know. But it was certainly a very powerful thing. And there's the story of Apollo's son. The one who drove his chariot for a day. Yes, thank you very much. I had a mental block. Who one day requested, he was offered, he was given a promise by Apollo, his father, that he would grant him a request. And one thing he requested was that he could drive the fiery chariot for a day. And of course, Apollo tried to dissuade him from it because he knew how difficult the job was to keep the sun, to keep the chariot on its correct course and to guide it in its appointed way among the constellations. But Phaeton insisted, and of course got in the chariot and found that he couldn't handle it. The horses that pulled the chariot were far too headstrong and took off, and the sun got all off its course, and it caused chaos, absolute chaos, because lands were being burned up and seas were being burned dry, and in the end they had to call on Jupiter, the most powerful of the gods, to actually strike Phaeton down with his thunderbolt to stop this chaos. So to me that was very symbolic too of understanding the necessity for keeping ourselves on a direct course, for not wavering from what our purpose, our will is, because the symbolizes the will, the purpose, and the steadfast need to just keep on being radiating what our essence is, what we're meant to be true to your own individuality, to not let anyone take the power from you, and to not let anyone divert you or put you off your course, because again, chaos will result. Okay, can anyone?
I was just thinking about fate, and Platon's fate was to be attached to a vehicle, a horse-drawn vehicle, in the 18th century, I think, which was, I suppose, the equivalent of a what now would be a maybe an MG sports car type of thing. Platon was a very sort of young bucks kind of light and fast vehicle.
That's true. That's right. That's right.
It's for the
that's
dandies
right.
to
yeah.
show up to the ladies,
yes.
so it's pushing
yes.
through
which
town there,
and so on. No, that's right.
Yeah.
Okay, so we've already had a look at the sun, symbolised.
Just a little input there, there's an interesting side version to that. As a kid in Enid Blyton, my dad in Enid Blyton's rendering of it, and she sort of said that this was basically the reason why the Negroes were black. Because he came so close to the Negro people in the world.
Oh,
we're
frightened. Oh, thank you. That's incredible.
Well, I know about that whole story was how Jupiter came down to rescue the situation.
How Jupiter came to rescue the situation. Thank
with
you.
With a thunderbolt.
Yes, not the handy old Jupiter. This is what surprises you. But,
yeah, well, Schnepper, I'll fix him. Can't have this.
Okay, but so, you know,
I think that's
our sun does represent our will and our purpose, and we have to look at our sun to see what our purpose is, what we are striving to become. And as you can see, each one of us has expressed, what we are tuning into when we're talking about what our will is, what our purpose is in our life. Right? Does everyone feel comfortable with that?
I think it's been a wonderful experience to have this thing happen. I really do. I think it's taught, it's helped to understand. We're here for astrology, I know.
Yeah.
But same with your workshops. Now you're given this other area which is. It's non-technical in a sense, but I don't
know. Yeah. Well, as I said, this is new for me, so I have to try to state something different.
Yes,
very
interesting.
How about the moon? We talked about our own personal moons. The moon, Diana, or Artemis, whether you're talking about it or Greek, of course. She is the twin sister of Apollo, and as he rules the day, she rules the night. He rules the conscious, she rules the unconscious, the male or female. And they're twins, alright? They're two manifestations of the one. Okay? And they cannot operate without each other. They do
just
get
the sun moon.
Yes, I think the sun does need the moon. Because
they are the same size.
Because the sun rules half the day. The moon, the sun goes back to its palace
well,
in the east.
Yeah, to me, in the law, you need the energy from the sun to be able to push out your emotions.
That's right. The moon is a reflection of the sun, and it receives the energies of the sun. That's why the moon represents our sensitive, intuitive, receptive side of ourselves. And it puts it out again.
Yeah, how could you
it's
be around the night if you didn't have moonlight to see by?
That's right. The moon is also, it's very, very powerful. And again, the moon has two manifestations as well. When there is some, we said there's no dark side of the moon. How about Hecate, who is also connected with the moon, associated with the moon? And she is the dark side of the and she's associated with witchcraft and sorcery, the goddess of the dead, and she wanders unseen at night. And she's unseen. Diana Tifakunas is seen. She's visible.
This is a side to me, she keeps going, was it Kate? Rebecca Cato.
Yes, yes. And she is the dark side. And she is the she's an even deeper archetype, I think, which we all have within us.
She's like the Pluto side of the moon.
She's the Pluto side.
Yeah, Pluto.
That's right. And Diana, she is the feminine principle at work in our charts, and we need that. We need to work with our masculine. I don't really like dividing it into sexes, because we get certain connotations that sort of does its own symbology. But the more receptive, intuitive side of it needs to be worked with. I like to think of the sun as being the conscious world and the moon being the unconscious world. We're working a lot more with what lies under the surface when we're talking about the moon.
I should see this, trying to get the sun to start penetrating into the moon as well. We're all trying to get them both to work together.
To work together, that's right, that's right. As someone was saying the other day too, that men really have to start integrating their moons a lot more, bringing them out, a lot more tuning in, contemplating and bringing them out. And women, I think they're ahead. I think they have already begun operating their suns. They're already asserting their individuality and claiming their own power.
That's
and not being
the
main rejection of the male ego. Finding our own egos. I think that this is already happened or happening. It's in the process of happening.
I don't think men first contacted their moon until women did that too.
No.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
I think it was absolutely essential.
Right. And of course Diana in myth is the protector of females, the protector of feminine. I didn't always like her methods of protection.
She's the goddess of childbirth.
She's the goddess of childbirth, although she's a virgin herself. But she's very much the protector of women. But those women that are being pursued by men, I know it's incredibly symbolic, but her followers, her virgin followers, and one of the gods or mortals were in pursuit and they were gaining on them. And they called on Diana. Her answer was usually to turn them into a tree. Which is, I'm not quite sure.
It's a bad symbol.
Well, but also, I see it being the very strong moon Cancer thing, the protectiveness, the hard shell coming around, sort of closing in. You have Cancer, the side Cancer, it can turn right in on itself, pull its shell over its top and knob and get through that shell. And so it's just another thing that tends to associate with the moon.
She was also very wild and slightly unpredictable.
Yes.
And is the unconscious.
It is, yes.
That's what I say, the inconsistency.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Well,
yes,
it's
quite
strongly
and
associated
and
with insanity and werewolves and
yeah, that's
the darker
side.
The
side of the moon. The fear, what we're afraid of. You know, maybe we have to go even that bit deeper and find what are we afraid of.
And Origins was also the huntress, you know, so I think that's a connection with the werewolf, and that's moon,
yes.
Animalism.
Yes.
Another thing I associate with the moon is, in the area of cosmetics, it's the face cosmetics a woman will prepare her face with.
Right.
Well, it gives her an opportunity to become another being.
Mm-hmm.
And men don't have that possibility except through costume, but not, you can't alter. Men don't offer this skin except
they can.
The
choose not to. It's not
this
kind of
in this
no,
century
like
it hasn't been really
encouraged.
Yes. I remember seeing
17th century it was on.
Mm. Oh yes, that's true.
Mm. Yeah, it's just right now a bit more of a period. Although Boyd George is changing that.
Yeah,
yeah, he has that quality of expressing that moon quality to his face.
Mm.
He has a moon face in the
yeah.
centre.
Mm. But there's Marilyn, and there's all sorts of male transvestite characters happening now. So, yeah, it's changing.
seems to be more I call pumpkin. More pumpkin way to play than whatever it was. Years ago.
Yeah.
Does that mean?
Well, I find this interesting because it took in relation to your idea about maintaining contact with this movement. The very big movements like music, particularly, you see it, where men claim of being sort of androgynous, it's more and Aquarius to me is that androgynous sense, like even you were saying in your talk, is that bringing the balance together and trying to balance yourself rather than being overvalued in one section.
I think David Byrne is a beautiful example of that.
Yes. Well, I see the moon really like a transformer, like an electrical transformer that transforms that powerful, unstructured energy of the sun and transforms it into a form that we can use in productive ways.
Okay, so it takes the energy that just put out of us and returns to its own form.
It couldn't handle
these things
and makes it possible for us to use it.
Right.
Well, I might think sunlight, but I think sunburns.
Yeah, good break. Really nice.
I'm afraid I spend most of my time on the sun, but I just going to say a few more quick words about, say, Mercury.
Tell us about your favourite one.
My favourite one.
In the mythology. You tell us about your favourite
one. My favourite, symbolised on the chart.
No, that doesn't
I'm
mean.
Very
well,
fond
which
of
is
the
your
moon.
Favourite mythological figure?
I'm very fond of the moon, Diana. Of course, I'm quite attracted to Venus in many ways.
Well, tell us about Venus, but you're also saying.
Okay, well, Venus in mythology is sort of very mixed.
Well, that's
we tend to sort of think it in our chart as a symbol of perfection and beauty and harmony and love, and which it is, which Venus did symbolise all these things. But she also came across many times as being vain and vindictive, and when she was slighted, she would cause pain or suffering or disaster. She put it through Mars sometimes, or through Eros. You know, she'd get her own back through afflicting someone with love.
Yeah.
How's that?
Just stick a kid on him.
Kid,
come get it.
That's right. She'd persuade someone else. I mean, she's very magnetic, very attractive, very beautiful. And it showed the danger of being totally wrapped up in your Venus. Totally devoted to creating such a harmony and balance and beauty that others actually become ignored or become overpowered or overwhelmed or get hurt. There is that danger. I love the story of the golden apple where the gods were all at a feast. And Minerva, Juno, and Venus were there in discord. Yeah, it was discord that was not invited to the feast. And as a result of this, threw an apple into the room with the caption on it, "For the fairest." And of course, through this, among the goddesses, and we had Minerva, Juno, and Venus contesting this apple. They all said it was for them. And Paris was called to adjudicate and to choose the most fair. And Juno promised him, they were all bribing him like crazy. They're just so human. And Juno was promising him power and riches, and Minerva was promising him glory in war and authority, power, and Venus offered him, knew exactly his failings, and the most beautiful woman in the world is his wife, which of course provoked the Trojan War, because when Paris saw Helen, naturally fell in love with her, carted her off to Troy, and this caused the what seems to have been the biggest upheaval in the known world at that time. And it was all done through vanity, beauty, love. Love was the bride. In order
she
to
just failed to tell him that the most beautiful woman in the world was already married.
Yes. And of course, this divided the class as well, because they all started changing sides. And Venus is not the gentle, beautiful creature that we know. We've got to be aware of that other side of Venus. We've got to keep that image of the beauty and the harmony and the love. But once it turns into selfishness, then we're lost, and it unleashes her opposite, Mars, war, strife.
I actually like to look at it as repressing some element of that love in yourself. Because, you know, when that came out, it was because she was ignored. Someone else was sent to be here or something like that. You know, so that she was denied in some form. So
yes,
again, it sort of gets back to actually recognizing the whole. So, and if you're oppressing something, it's got to come up in some way.
That's right.
So it's push up.
The whole thing trying to get that too. Recognizing the gods in our chart, tuning into their energies, acknowledging them, working with them, concentrating on the purest and highest form of that energy and trying to express that. And perhaps I ought to say something. Oh, perhaps I ought to, I'd like to say something about Jupiter too.
Could I ask you one question about Venus?
Yeah.
I often wonder that I've got it at 29.5 degrees. And that's a Libra. So that's right, I know it was Libra and it's right there. How much does that other sign, you know, fraction of the other sign, influence the quality of the Venus at that number of degrees?
It's a hairy one, because some people argue that because it's already partly, and it would be physically partly into that other sign, and partly in the other, that both are important. My own impression, and this is a personal thing, is that a planet in the last degree of a sign is very much a potent manifestation of that sign, because it's the finishing off of that sign before it moves into the next. Of course,
well, somebody changed my chart. You know, someone said, "Oh, you've only got a solar chart." And I thought, and then I ended up with a totally different chart, and it moved to Venus into Scorpio. But anyway, I found out that my own number was wrong. Really was right, and I felt so relieved when I went back to my proper
chart.
Well,
there you are. That's what feels comfortable with you. That is, that is.
Yes,
accept that and work with that. You've got to work with the energies that you're comfortable with. Yep. Okay. So Jupiter, who of course the god is the god of the head of the gods. It's lovely to sort of now tune into the fact that we know Jupiter. It's the biggest of the planets. I mean, that would have been obvious too. It's the biggest. And
you should have seen
the
photo of it last night.
Oh, yes. It is beautiful.
Oh.
And also, now that they've discovered that Jupiter actually puts out more energy and more heat than it receives. So it has got a core from which it radiates. It is a god. It is a sun, almost. So among the planetary family, it is the biggest, most important. And of course, in our chart, it does symbolise that, where we can grow, where we can put out our energy to others, put out our energy, heal, grow, expand. Alright? And so that is quite important.
Is that where its generosity can come in, because it most probably produces the sun, and
yes.
Then it gets tiny bit for itself.
Yes.
So it's selfish.
Also, it's interesting that Jupiter, as among the gods, has the power. I'm rushing now because I'd like to talk about Saturn too. The image of Saturn that we have is one of harsh, well, on the negative side, harshness, cruelty, restriction. That's the negative side. The positive side, of course, is discipline, the ability to concentrate our energies, and we get the rewards of however we have used our Saturn. There also are strange stories about Saturn. In fact, when he devoured all his children, he thought that we were going to Jupiter, who managed to rescue them. He saw his stone in Jupiter's place and was tricked into disgorging all of them, including his son. But Jupiter helped to overthrow him. But we have very different images of Saturn too. If you read about in mythology, Saturn is actually connected with the Golden Age, the age of total harmony, everything working, the harvests, the life living, life going on in a peaceful way where everyone was happy and love abounded. The only thing I can think of connecting with that is that because the laws of Saturn were not being transgressed and not being rejected, then these are the golden rewards of Saturn. Also, Glenn was already mentioned the Feast of the Saturnalia, in which it was a day of festivities, celebrating, and giving the presents, they gave presents, and no punishments were carried out on that day, criminals were not punished. Slaves and masters exchanged places, which is a symbol of the equality of all mankind. The masters actually waited on the slaves, and it was a day of celebration, goodwill, and harmony among everyone. And this is just another phase of Saturn, which has not really been emphasised.
You know, Kathy, when thinking of those photographs of Saturn last night, it is so beautiful and so ordered and so pure.
Yes.
But I can understand that people living under that aspect of it wouldn't have that harmony under the night.
Yes.
And if you look at Capricornian Saturn, some Capricorn women have the most marvellous bone structure. They don't seem to age, and they also elegant, and they have costumes, all the
same exactly.
And that we're seeing that sort of Neptune in Capricorn now, that's coming through in clothing, and the whole thing's changing.
Yes.
Carrying that.
Well, there are a lot of more recent works about Saturn too that have changed the thinking a little. There's green Saturn, so it's a beautiful.
I really think the Saturn in my chart is my best friend.
That's right. Make friends with Saturn. I think I died. Encourage
it. Saturn became the ruler of the eyes of the blessed ones in the Sylveon.
That's true.
Yes,
he did.
And, it's the same thing. When he was no longer the mentor of men, you could see that he was at a time.